Good morning and welcome to Ridgely Christian Church. We are so grateful that you are worshiping with us this Sunday, whether it is your first time with us or you've been here a million times before. We invite you to grab elements for communion, bread and juice, coffee and crackers, donuts and orange juice, whatever that might look. Light a candle, find a comfortable place, and be there, present, ready to worship the living God. If you're watching with us on Facebook, share this video with your friends if you feel comfortable. Also on Facebook, we invite you to join us by commenting on this video as you watch and interact with us. We will be posting the link in the comments for attendance, and this will also be posted in the chat if you're joining via Zoom. A few announcements. This week, we will have our normal Bible study classes. Tuesday at 11 o'clock is our disciples class. And Wednesday at 11:15 is our open door class, both on Zoom. Sunday at 10 o'clock is our children's Sunday school, which will meet on Google Meets. Also on Sunday is youth group at 4 o'clock via Zoom. If you would like more information on these, please reach out and we will get you plugged in. On Wednesday, January 13th, we will meet with our Bible study with community at 7 o'clock. Our new leaders meeting, originally scheduled for this Wednesday, has been pushed back to January 20th, also at 7 o'clock p.m., to set goals and to dream about where God is calling us this new year. Today is Pastor Catherine's last Sunday with us, after a year-long tenure as the Minister of Administration. We are so grateful for you, Pastor Catherine, for all you have done for this church community, and we are so glad to have been part of your life. We wish you the best as you continue going on where God is calling you next. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful and full of majesty. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord sits enthroned forever. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. May the Lord give strength to God's people and bless us with peace.
The light of God is in this place.
Wait in the water, wait in the water, Jesus. Please join me in reading the responsive litany as found in the order of worship. From the waters of creation, the earth sprang forth. From the waters of a womb, God's blessed Son was given to us. From the waters of a river, people were baptized and marked as God's children. Praise be to God, whose loving gifts and presence have called us together. Let us shout our love to God for God's abundant love. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning, friends. Good morning, beloved children of God. It's so good to see you this morning. What do I have here today? Can you tell? What is this? Water. I have water. Our story in our Bible today is about Jesus and the water. Do you like to play in the water? My dad's favorite thing to do in the water is to go fishing. Do you like to go fishing? Jesus liked to go fishing. Spencer's favorite thing to do in the water is to play in his bath. He has his cool rubber duck. Whoa, look at it go. He's stuck in his boat. I like that water helps us. When we're dirty, water can help us to be clean and take it all clean. And when plants need food, the rain waters them and they can grow. Water helps us grow. And when we're thirsty, we can have some water to drink and it helps us to feel all better. Water does so many things for us. In the church, we use water for baptism. Have you heard that word? Baptism. In our story in our Bible today, Jesus gets baptized. When we get baptized, it's our commitment that we want to follow Jesus and God forever. Let me show you about baptism in our church. Have you ever wondered what's behind these beautiful stained glass windows right here in our sanctuary? This is our baptistry. Let me show it to you. You'll take a class with one of our pastors to learn about getting baptized. And on the day of your baptism, you'll walk back here, back behind the sanctuary. Did you know this was back here? You'll walk up these steps. Here we go. And you will walk right here into the baptistry. On the day of your baptism, it will be filled with water. And the minister will open up the window. Open up the window. And you'll look out and you'll see the church. You will see all of the faces of our church who love you, watching you as you make your commitment to follow Jesus. And when you are in here, the pastor will ask you, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and the Savior of our world? And you will say yes. And then the pastor will say, therefore I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And she will take you in her arms and will dip you down into the water and bring you back up. And you will look out into the church at all of these people who have also committed their life to following Jesus.
On the day that Jesus got baptized, that Jesus said, I will commit all of my life to following God. When Jesus came up from the water, the sky parted and a voice came and said, this is my beloved son with whom I am well pleased. When you are baptized, the skies may not part, but God will say to you, as God says now, you are my beloved child, with whom I am well pleased. I will never leave you. When the waters of life are calm and everything is easy, I will be with you. And when the waters of life are wild and hard and scary, I will never, ever leave you. My love will be with you always. Water, the water of baptism, is very powerful. I hope you know always that you are God's beloved, and I can't wait to see the ways that you share God's love with the world around you. Bye, friends.
There are so many people to keep in our prayers this week, so many things to pray about and for. I would like to lift up a few names specifically. Please keep Diana Schlotterbeck in your prayers as she is recovering from a hand injury that required stitches. I also invite you to keep Jeff Boyles in your prayers as he has health concerns that may lead to possible brain surgery. And let us also keep John and Lauren Padilla in our prayers as they tested positive for COVID. And extend those prayers to Lauren's mom and Aiden that they stay well. Let us continue to keep the families who have lost loved ones in the last few weeks in our prayers, surrounding them with love and comfort during this time of grief. Let us take a moment of silence to share the prayers that are in our hearts with the holy. Oh God, we need you now. We need to see you, to hear you, to feel you, and to know that your justice will reign. God, give us what we need to be and do better. The ability to realize our own complacency, the ability to speak up when we see injustice, the strength to continue the hard work of building your kingdom. Oh God, let us no longer stand aside, no longer keep quiet, no longer let apathy dominate our actions or inaction. God, let us cry out to you when we see your people are hurting. Let us passionately, enthusiastically denounce violence. Let us call out the sin of racism that flows through our country. Let us do the work, oh God, that we must do to be better. We have seen this week the reality of our country, the brokenness, the racism, the idolatry, the violence, and we cannot deny it any longer. But we must address it and confront it and name it for the sins that they are. God, oh God, we fall on our knees and cry out to you to hear our prayers. Hear our prayers. Hear our prayers. And let us not forget these prayers that we have said today. May they remain in our hearts. And as we cry out to you these prayers, may we not forget those countless people who have been impacted by this pandemic. We lift up, oh God, people who need comfort, who need healing and peace, who need hope. You, oh God, know all the prayers that we cry out to you, the prayers that are spoken out loud, the prayers that sit quietly in our hearts. And oh God, may your spirit pour out on us. And may it be a healing balm to our soul. Amen. The journey we are on right now is one we are on together. We don't always know where it will go or what twists and turns will happen. We don't know how long the stretches in the wilderness will last. But what we do know about this journey is that it is done as a community and that we have the amazing good news of Jesus to lead us along the way. The good news that involves clothing those who need it, feeding the hungry, finding shelter for the refugee, welcoming and loving the stranger. We may feel like we are in the middle of a very long patch of wandering through the wilderness, but these ministries still happen. These ministries that reflect the things that Jesus calls us to do still happen even when we wander through the wilderness. And maybe they might be even more important during these wilderness times. And these ministries cannot happen without you and your support. Your offering helps support ministries at Ridgely that share the good news, provide clothing, feed the hungry, shelter the refugee, and they help us welcome and love all. You can make your online offering or donation by going to the Shelby website that is on your screen or by mailing a check to the church. Thank you so much for being a part of this community as we journey together through the wilderness, living out and sharing the good news.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above, ye heavenly host. Creator, Christ, and Holy Ghost.
Will you pray with me? Eternal God, we come before you in humility, but not with our heads bowed, but looking to you for your guidance. Even with all of the things we do through your divine interventions, we need constant reminders to do your will and maintain the discipleship that your Son taught us. As we partake of the bread and the cup, we remember Jesus' teachings and his sacrifices for us. Be with us, O God, as we spread the good news. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Will you please join me in singing Sweet, Sweet Spirit?
This week, amidst everything, I came across something written by Morgan Harper Nichols, and it made me think of this table. There are no two sides of the aisle in the kitchen. There's a table, there are chairs, there are human beings bound together by a need for nourishment. And in order for that to happen, we have to bring our ingredients together and work to create a feast so that everyone can be fed. For unity to happen, we have to acknowledge the ingredients that have worked and the ones that have been missing in the kitchen. There are no two sides of the aisle. There is a pot in front of us, and it's time to cook. Some of what we will try won't work. Some of what we will try will. But the water is already boiling on the stove, and we need to eat. Let's get to work. So here we are at this table. We come here every week and take a moment celebrating the importance of community and how much we need each other. Once seated, like many meals, we don't think about the time and energy it took to prepare for us to be here in this place, all of the work. But as Jesus looked around the room that night, as he broke bread, as he saw his own community, I wonder if maybe he was thinking about just that. All of the hard and difficult work that he had done that had led them here, and all that still had to be done. As he passed around what they had available, sharing it with each of his friends, telling all of them to take, eat. I want you to remember me and the work I have done so that any time you eat, you are reminded that this is important. Remember to continue building relationships with people who make you uncomfortable and expand this table as far as you can, making sure everyone has something to eat. And in the same way, he took what they had to drink, passed it to each of them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you." And every time you have a drink, remember all of the work needing to be done to make sure that everybody is at this table and feeling like they are welcome. Friends, I invite you to take comfort in this meal that you are invited to. And at the same time, name all of the work that needs to be done. The pot is boiling. It's time. And now I invite you to join me in saying the prayer that we were taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee, e though it be a cross that raiseth me, still all my song shall be nearer, my God, to thee, nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee. Though like the sun gone down, darkness be over me, my rest a stone. Yet in my dreams I'd be nearer, my God, to thee. Steps unto heaven, all that thou sendest me in mercy give. Angels to beckon me,
Scripture reading today comes from Mark, chapter 1, verses 4 through 11. Listen for how God may be speaking to us today through Holy Scripture. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
One of my absolute favorite parts of being a minister is having the joy and the opportunity to be able to walk alongside people as they are exploring whether or not they want to be baptized. And some of the most beautiful moments in my memory are those times that I have the opportunity to immerse someone in the baptismal waters when they say, "Yes, I am here and I am ready and I believe. And when I think of each of these memories, I am overwhelmed with feelings of beauty and sweetness and awe. These almost perfect feeling memories are powerful. Even when what's going on around them may have been a little more less than ideal or maybe even fully chaotic, the memories that I have of baptizing people are always just so, so delicate and precious and wonderful. And we often use this kind of language when we think about baptism, don't we? Just washing and wonder and awe and beauty and perfection. And these feelings, they are real and they fill us. But today I want us to think about baptism with a slightly different perspective. Debbie Thomas reflects on today's scripture and she says that the language in it is feral and untamed and unpredictable and wild. And I want us to use that lens today as we look at our text. I do highly encourage you taking some time on your own to go to the website Journey with Jesus and read her essay on wild water, where she frames baptism in these unpredictable and untamed and feral ways, and it is beautiful and wonderful and powerful. So I do encourage you to take time to read her essay. But I now want us to take that idea, take that mindset of thinking about baptism and feral and wild and unpredictable and untamed ways. Let's take this mindset, take this lens as we dive into our text for today. We find ourselves at the very beginning of the Gospel of Mark. We have just passed the whole in the beginning of the good news part, and we are now into our introduction of John the Baptizer. This is a man, a wild man. He is wearing camel's hair, which we can, you know, fairly assume that was not the norm of the time. Not only was he dressed in wild ways, but he also ate wild things, locusts and wild honey, which wild honey is from the inside of an animal carcass. Or it could be found with, you know, in trees and rocks, but those two sound much less interesting than thinking of someone who is just really in the embodiment of wild. And he did things in his own wild way. He shared a message of good news, preparing the way, and he baptized people in the wild, all pulling people away from the norm, from the spiritual center of the city. He did all of this in the wild, and people came from all over, and they listened to him. They heard his words, the words that he preached, and they came into the wild to be baptized by him in the wild. And his message, he told them to name their sins. And so let us pause our story for just a minute, this story about a wild man, as he is calling out to the people to name their sins and change their ways. Y'all, we can learn a lot from John's message. We have some sins that we need to name this week, and we must name them before we can move on with our scripture. We must name them if there is ever to be transformation on this journey we are on. So where do we start with what all even gets named? We are in the wild, and there is so much. There is so much. Let us name and call out the sin of racism and idolatry and violence and destruction and hate. We have seen and experienced all of these this week. And as we name these sins, and as we believe in change and transformation that can happen, let us know that naming these sins, calling them out, is an important part of the journey and the work of transformation. Naming them, calling them out, not just when we see them in others, but also when we see them in ourselves. It is hard. It is hard to name all the ways that we have participated and been complicit in all of this. It is hard to wrap our heads around the depth of the communal and institutional sins that we have seen and experienced this week. And it feels so, so untamable. It feels untamable. But here is the thing. Here's the thing. See, John prepared the way, teaching us to call out, to name our sins. And he pointed us into the direction of Jesus. His message did not stop with simply call out your sins, name your sins. No, he pointed towards Jesus and told us that Jesus, he is going to transform the way. John teaches us the hard practice of calling out those things in our world that try to separate us from God, that try to separate us from those who bear the image of God. And because we are going to follow this wild and unpredictable journey of Jesus, we need to be prepared by being able to see and name these things that are going to try to separate us from this journey. And it is hard. It is hard work, and it must be done. Speaking, though, of hard work and wild journeys and unpredictable things, what is important is that our scripture that challenges us to this hard work, it doesn't stop there. It doesn't stop with this wild man teaching us to call out sin. No, no. Our scripture goes on, where John, who has the first spoken words of a character in the Gospel of Mark, John's first words are him proclaiming that the one who is more powerful than I, more powerful than him, is coming after me. He says, I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. These are the words of John. These are the first spoken words in the Gospel of Mark, and they are powerful words because they are teaching us that more is to come. The journey does not just stop here. It continues in wild and unpredictable ways. And bam, guess what? Jesus shows up. He shows up after these words that are shared by John. He shows up and does some things that were apparently a bit wild and untamed and unpredictable, even scandalous. So here are all these sinners who are sitting around listening to John preach, being baptized him all in the wild, listening to John who is preparing the way, and all of a sudden Jesus shows up in this wild place among these wild people to be baptized. Like, dude, Jesus, what sins do you need to name? What do you need forgiveness from? Why are you being baptized in the same waters as these wild people? Aren't you like above that? So I actually went down a bit of a scriptural commentary rabbit hole when I realized how scandalous Jesus being baptized was, especially for the early church. I'm not gonna totally geek out about this new thing I learned, but what I want to say and let you know is that Jesus being baptized in the wild by this wild man amongst these wild people, it was scandalous. And learning just how scandalous this act was makes this whole story more wild, makes Jesus being baptized even more unpredictable. And it's showing us that Jesus isn't here to do anything typical. Oh no, he is here to do the unpredictable. So when Jesus is baptized, then the Holy Spirit comes down and we hear this voice in the wild say, "This is my beloved and I am pleased." One way we can look at this text is that in the middle of the wild, Jesus shows up among the people. Not above, not separate, but among. And he is ready to do the work of God. And boy, there is work to be done. John prepared the way, but Jesus is here to transform the way, showing us what it means to lead with love. Jesus didn't ask for a private baptism or one to be held in a super holy place or by special extra holy people. No, he went out to the wild among the wild people and was baptized by a wild man in a river, showing us that the work of leading with love, the work of being with, the work of building the kingdom, it's a journey of being among. It is a journey that is wild and unpredictable. It is a journey that often takes hard work. It takes dismantling things that lead to oppression. It takes listening to people that often go unnoticed. And it takes creating connections between God and the people of God. And it takes seeing and naming the sins of the world that try to tear us apart and showing up to do the work of creating healing and wholeness and togetherness. I think that's in part why I've always found baptism so beautiful, is that for me, it isn't so much about the theological perspective of washing away sin, but more so saying, I am here, God, and I am ready. And I don't know where this journey is going to go, but I know there is work to be done, and I am here for it. And think about your baptism. What journey have you gone on since then? Did it always lead you to the places you expected? Did it lead you into the wild? What kind of hard work have you had to do along the way? Where have you grown? When have you led with love? When have you been loved? When have you been transformed? When have you seen God? And here you are today, beloved, seeing the work that needs to be done, calling it out, naming it, and still showing up and saying, here I am. I am ready. I am ready, oh God, to do your work and share your love in the world. See, in our scripture, John helps us to see the work that needs to be done in ourselves and in the world. And then Jesus shows up and shows us how that work is to be done. He teaches us about showing up and that God's love is unpredictable, untamable, and transformative. and that building the kingdom together, not separate, but among. It is a wild, wild journey. And the journey begins when you show up. Amen. And friends, if you are on a part of your journey where you want to know more about Jesus, more about what it means to show up and say yes to God, more about what it means to be part of this faith community here at Ridgely Christian Church, we would love to hear from you, to get to know you more and to share more about us and what we believe here at Ridgely, what we believe as part of the Disciples of Christ. So feel free to send us a message on whatever platform you are worshiping on, and we look forward to hearing from you.
This year. She came to Ridgely after her graduation from Vanderbilt Divinity School to serve with us as a resident minister, to serve with us as a minister of administration in ways that we never would have thought we would have needed or expected the kinds of skills that she brought to us. She was with us for about a month. Is that right, Catherine? Before?
Yep.
About a month. Before the pandemic hit, before COVID began, and got to know us a little bit in person and meet some of our neighbors and see some of our outreach ministries. And then we went online. And Catherine is the minister we needed in 2020. Catherine, you brought to us not only your sense of administration, your organization, your technological skills, your efficiency, your way of keeping all connected and teaching us all new technology in ways we never would have thought or imagined, and that were kind, but you also brought to us a deep pastoral sense, a deep care and compassion for each of us in our congregation, for our world as it was hurting. You brought to us a prophetic voice. What does it look like to be the church of God's love, standing out for justice and for peace today when we're all in our homes on screens? What does it look like to keep being the church? You taught us that. You showed us that. You lived that out for us. We are grateful beyond words for your ministry with us this year, your ministry to us this year, your partnership with us. I am grateful for your friendship, for the ways that we have gotten to do ministry together. Catherine is leaving us now to go to Danville, Kentucky, where she will be serving as an associate pastor. And I hope they know they are the luckiest church on the planet. They are getting so many incredible gifts of ministry in Catherine. You will be missed here. Dearly, dearly, dearly. And you will always have a home here. Before you leave, we wanted to offer a blessing for you. Would that be okay? Let us pray. God of love, God of grace, God of transitions, God, be in Catherine's life. God, bless her. We give you thanks for her ministry, for the ways that she daily, again and again, says yes to you. Yes to sharing your love with the world that is hurting. Yes to helping people to connect, to realize that we are one body in Christ, even when we can't see each other. Yes to sharing your love with the world around us. God, as she goes off into this new adventures in ministry, into this new journey, go with her every step of the way, and we know you will. God, be close enough for her to touch as close as her very breath. May she know that she is never alone. But as she speaks your good word, a word that is so needed in our world right now, embolden her, empower her, and be her place to rest. May she always know that she has home here at Ridgely Christian Church in this part of the body of Christ, that here she always has a place. God, we give you thanks for her life, for her ministry with us, and her ministry. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Catherine, for your ministry. Really, beyond words. Thank you. It's been a gift.
It has been a joy and an adventure to get to know you all during this very weird year, and it's been weird, but I am thankful for all of you journeying along with me this year, and I will miss you all and look forward to seeing you in person one day.
We can't wait till we can be face to face. Thank you for your ministry.
Yeah.
Beloveds, it is time to show up and say, yes, God, I am here, ready to be your love in the world and to do your work. Be filled with the Holy Spirit this week. May it transform your life and radiate into your home, into your community, and into the world. Amen.